We already started the third unit, that is about mobile IP. So in the previous two units, we discussed about what is the theme to get into the mobile computing environment. That is nothing but what are all the fundamentals that we need, communication fundamentals that we need in order to get aware of mobile computing environment. And we explained about and we discussed about various modulation schemes, accessing schemes, and also various techniques which are being used for mobile computing environment, especially that is the frequencies that are related for mobile computing, the schemes that are being followed for the mobile computing, how you are being choosing about the customers, what are all the different digital standards that are being coming over, that are being existing, that are being evoluted in various versions, in various generations regarding the mobile communication, that what all we discussed in the first unit. And regarding that mobile communication and computing environment, the popular protocol that we discussed there itself, that is the GSM protocol, Global System for Mobile Communication, and how it has came into existence, how it has become popular, what are all its architectures, and what are all its protocols that we have followed for. Okay, right. So for that one, what are all the techniques that we have to learn, how it has been working, everything has been shown in the first unit. And coming to the second unit, we discussed about how the data leak layer will be helpful for us, in which the MAC has been, how it has been playing a major role, which is acting between the corresponding network layer and also the physical layer in establishing a logical connection and in sending the data from one sender party to the receiver party. Okay, so what are all its different accessing schemes that has been working with in those particular accessing environments and accessing methodologies, how it has been working, how it has been sending data, how it has been maintaining the connections while moving over, that is the subscribers are moving over, and all those has been discussed. And in working with MAC, in conjunction with the MAC, what about the wireless LAN that has been helpful for us in mobile computing environment? We discussed about the 802.11 version, right? And now we are discussing about the third lowest layer. That is nothing but only the three sub-layers are being helpful for us in the mobile communication environment. That is what we discussed in the very very first class while discussing about the protocol stack that will be helpful for us in the mobile communication. That is, in the available seven layers of the communication protocol stack, we are being helpful with the three lower layers that are being useful for the mobile communication, right? In that particular mobile communication environment, in the three layers, we discussed about all the data link layer in which MAC will be helpful for us and how the MAC is going to be doing the communication in between while sensing the communication medium or the transmission medium, sensing the carrier signal and identifying the procedures and how it has been sending the signals, how it has been reaching the receivers station and how it has been maintaining the connectivity in between the sender and the receiver and all those things, right? Now we are been moving with the network layer. That is nothing but how you are going to what is called routing over, that is why how you are been approaching our receiver, that is how you are been connecting with the external network where all the parties and all the communicating nodes are being interconnected. That is, we are one of the part of the communicating node and we want to communicate with the other parties on the other side of the communication network, so that we have to find out that where is our required target communication node, right? In that case, while finding out our receiving subscriber or our other party of communication, that is the communication may be taking place not only between one and two, it may be between many number of parties. So while doing so, that is while communicating with the one party or while communicating with many number of other parties, how we have to get route to that particular one. And at the same time, we know that in the mobile communication, we do doesn't exist in a static manner. We'll have the users in a mobile what is called as movement. That is, the mobile user may not be stick on to a particular static location. He may move over. He may be changing from one radio cell to the another radio cell. And we may also change from one cell to the another radio cell. We may not be remain static. in that case, how the routes are to be get optimized, how the routes has to be find out first so that the target can be reached over, or the connection between the corresponding called user and the caller has to be retained until the call has been finished, or how the data has to be reached from sender to the receiver until the data has been completed in transferring the information. Right. So this is how you are going to be knowing and how you are going to be identifying in the IP layer or the network layer that you are going to discuss, right? And in the previous class, we discussed about what is a mobile IP and how you are going to be doing that mobile communication using this particular network layer, how you are being connecting to the external world by using this mobile IP. So yeah, as we have been entered into this third unit, that is about the mobile IP, that is nothing but the internet protocol layer, which will be helpful for us. The contents that we are going to discuss in this particular unit are nothing but the mobile network layer, that is how this particular network layer will be helpful for us in communicating. And next one is IP and mobile IP network layers. So what about the normal IP and what is the difference between this mobile IP and the normal IP network layers, and how the packet delivery will be done while communicating the data in between the two parties? And already we know about this handover mechanisms. Okay, so why do we need this particular handover mechanism is nothing but the communicating parties are not going to be static. They are not going to be remaining static. They are going to be moving over the globe. They may not be remaining to a static position. So while moving over, they are mean changing their radio cells. They are been changing their mobile switching centers. So how they has to be handing over from one particular radio cell to the another radio cell. That is from moving from one antenna that is being capturing their signals to the other antenna that they are going to get connected with. So that is the handover management. And according to that particular handover management itself, the location has to be identified. That is whether we are retaining in our own radio cell or you are being moving to the other radio cell. So that is to be identified. So based upon the location that you are being existing, it can be identified. So that how the location has to be identified, how it is to be managed. So based upon the location that you are being existing only, the radio cell will be get identified and the corresponding BSC and MSC are going to be get connected. See, all of you keep in mind about what are all these MSCs, what are all the BSCs, what are all the base transceiver system. Why? Because while discussing about all these stations and all these architectures, I already told you in the last two units, please keep on the fundamentals and keep a picture of the fundamentals in your mind. Every time I doesn't recollect what is the BSC and what is the MSC, what is the radio cell, how you are been moving from one radio cell to another radio cell, what is the handover, how you are been moving through, how the subscribers are going to be getting connected, how the call will be get managed, what is the mobile terminated call. All these are not going to be recollected for each and every class. Why? Because you have to have a picture that whenever any call has been initiated by any subscriber, how it has been reaching the corresponding receiver, what are all the other connecting nodes in between while managing this particular call until it has been getting terminated, right? So that you have to keep in mind all the fundamentals, that is the communication side techniques, that is modulation, accessing methodologies and all those things, and at the same time the mobile communication procedures like GSM architecture, GSM modules, GSM protocols, and also the corresponding MAC protocols, MAC architecture. Everything has to keep in mind by yourself. Until and otherwise you have a map of this, all these things in your mind, you couldn't understand the remaining topics that you are going to discuss in future, right? So for that one you have to keep all these things, right? So coming to this location management, until and unless we doesn't have the idea of the geolocation of a particular customer who is been moving over or roaming over, we couldn't manage with the handover mechanism. That is, we couldn't connect him to the corresponding radio cells into which he is been moving, right? And while he is been moving from one radio cells to the other radio cell, that is, okay, whatever it is, he is going to be registered with the new MSC or the new antenna, and whatever it is, controlling station or a base station he's been entered into, he has to get registered. And for that one, he has to be tunneling. That is, he's been moving from his own mobile station to the another mobile station, or whatever it is, base station to the another base station. So while moving over, he is having a new registration, he is having the new communication path or route to his particular subscriber. While doing so, how the data will be get protected, how the data will be get conveyed from the different paths while he is moving over. Why? Because not only in single communication path, the data or the voice is not going to be conveyed. While he is moving over from one cell to the other cell, or one area to the other area, the routes are going to be changed. That is nothing but your voice and your data is going to be moving from one part to the another part. So while doing so, how the tunneling and encapsulation of the data will be done. And at the same time, while moving from one area to the another area, how the particular what is called as routing, that is nothing but how your subscriber or the receiver is being connected from your side. While you are moving and while your receiver is being moving, the connecting path is going to be changing from time to time. Your connecting nodes are going to be changing. So how that particular connecting paths will be get optimized? They shouldn't be long. They has to be immediately connected. You and your subscriber has to be immediately connected to each other. You shouldn't feel any break in your call. You shouldn't feel any connectivity problem or connectivity change while you are maintaining the call, right? That is to be done by the route optimization. For the route optimization to be done at best, we are going to choosing a protocol that is nothing but the DHCP. That is nothing but dynamic host configuration protocol, which is playing a vital role in this particular mobile communication while the host is going to be dynamically changing over. That is, your routes are going to be changing over. How that particular routes are being maintained in a rapid way or in a dynamic way, that is because of the DHCP itself, right? And coming to the mobile IP, as need for mobile IP, that is nothing but how, why we are going to be going for mobile IP. Why couldn't we go for only the normal IP? Why? Because while connecting with the normal networks and while connecting with the general IP communication, right? That is, the IP addresses of the corresponding communicating nodes are not going to be changed. They are going to be remain stationary, or they're remain to be static. Whereas coming to this particular mobile IP, working with the mobiles, those IPs are going to be changed according to the location they are going to be changing. That is the need of the mobile IP, right? What is the need of the mobile IP? While working with the normal IP communication, internet protocol communication, the IP addresses that are assigned to the particular host or a particular customer are not going to be changed. They are going to be remained same while the communication is going on. Okay. But with the corresponding mobiles, corresponding mobiles are going to be changing their locations. They're changing their IP addresses. They're changing their routing paths. They're changing their communication paths, and they're moving over, right? So for that one, they has to change the addresses. But how could, with the normal IP communication, the host cannot change the IP addresses while going on sessions? That is nothing but while communicating itself, changing the IP addresses is not possible. And already you know that in our labs, while moving over, that is, while changing your IP addresses to get the internet in your mobiles or in your labs, okay, then the systems will not support the normal internet while you are working with your normal server communication. But if you want to work with the internet, the IPs has to change, right? Our programmers need to change the IP addresses, or you are being helped with our particular programmers in order to get the internet on your systems in the laboratories, right? So what you are doing while going with the normal working procedure, the host cannot change the IP addresses, and while going with the normal IP communication, the host couldn't change the IP addresses, but it couldn't be not in the case of the mobiles. While they are moving over from one location to the another location, the IP addresses has to be changed. So that is the thing that we have to do, which is not enough with the normal IP communication. Okay, the IP addresses are going to be changed and the routes are supposed to be get changed with from time to time. So that is the need of the mobile IP, right? So what is mobile IP? What you are going to do now? What is the mobility? Mobility is nothing but here, whenever the node of communication or the particular point of communication changing its point of attachment, the IP address has to be remained same, even though it is going to be maintaining. Mobility is the ability of a node to change its point of attachment while maintaining all existing communication and using the same IP address. Having the same IP address, it has to maintain with, or it has to change the existing communication, and existing communication change its point of attachment. It is going to be changing the point of attachment without changing the IP address while maintaining the same communication. There will not be any cut in your communication. We won't stop the communication while changing over, but we are going to be attached with the same address, but you are going to moving with or changing with the point of attachment, right? That is the mobility that we have to achieve. Okay, the node of communication has to change its point of attachment while maintaining the same communication and using the same IP address. That is nothing but the mobility that we have to achieve with the mobile IP. And coming to the another word that we have to learn here is nomadicity. Nomadicity is nothing but allowing a node to move, but it must terminate. Terminate all existing communications and then can change, initiate new connections with a new address. Okay, the communicating node is going to be move here, but it is terminating all the communications and then can initiate new connections with a new address. Nomadicity is different from the mobility. Nomadicity is the actual thing that is going with the normal IP communication. That is, whenever the node of communication is going to be moving, it is terminating the existing communications, all existing communications, and trying to get connect with the new addresses. That is the nomadicity that has been working with the actual IP communication. But with the mobile communication, it couldn't be. The node is going to be moving, but maintaining the existing communication without terminating it, but attaching with the same IP address, but changing the point of attachment with the next radio cell or the moved radio cell, right? That is the change in the mobility and the nomadicity. So finally, how you are going to defining this particular mobile IP is, it's a network layer solution. It's a network layer solution for all the types of mobile communicating devices, both the homogeneous and heterogeneous, on a global internet or the universal internet, which is to be scalable. That is, we can be adding many number of mobile nodes at any time, and robust. It couldn't change its nature, or it can withstand any type of characteristic. Secure, maintaining the security, and which is allowing to maintain all ongoing communications while moving. That is, the corresponding mobile IP should be a network layer solution, which is allowing you to maintain all ongoing communications while moving over the total universe or the globe, okay, while maintaining the scalability in adding many number of users to the communication and withstanding any type of calamities or any type of conditions, and securing your communication profiles at any cost. That could be the mobile IP. That we can define mobile IP as in that way, right? So this is the final definition of the mobile IP. It's a network layer solution, which is serving you both the homogeneous and heterogeneous users. Okay, and while maintaining your communication without any break, it is going to give you the scalable, robust, and secure feature for you. And coming to the design goals of mobile IP. So what are all the goals and what are all the different aims that it's been giving the introduction of the mobile IP? Why the mobile IP has been introduced? What are its aim actually? What is its theme actually by introducing of the mobile IP? So what is it is nothing but it is a one which has been introduced for dealing transparently with the problem of mobile users. It has been introduced for dealing with the problems of mobile users transparently. That is the first aim of the mobile IP. Next one is making the size and frequency of routing updates as small as possible. It is designed in such a way, it has been introduced as a special design in such a way that size and frequency required for the mobile users or the routing updates are going to be making as small as possible. That is nothing but with the available space, with the available minimum space, and with the availability of minimum frequency space, frequency band, we have to accommodate and we have to route up all the communication lines as small as possible. That is with the available small size of the space, with the available small size of frequency band, all the communication lines has to be get accommodated. That is another aim of the mobile IP. Next one is implementing the minimum mobile software. Implementing the minimum mobile node software. That is a simple software is needed. Not much of complex software. Simple software is needed on the mobile side of mobile communication node side in order to implement our mobile IP. Next one is designed to avoid solutions that require mobile nodes to use multiple addresses. Sorry, here it is not avoid. Designed to introduce solutions that require mobile nodes to use multiple addresses. That is nothing but not only maintaining a single IP address, it can also communicate with multiple number of addresses. That is, a mobile can address or communicate with multiple number of mobile communicating devices. That is designed to avoid solutions that require mobile need to use the multiple address. That is nothing but introduce the solution. That is enhancing the different types of solutions that are required by a mobile in order to communicate with multiple number of addresses at the same interval of time. So the aims of or the goals of mobile IP is nothing but dealing with the mobile user problems transparently and introducing the number of customers into the communication lines with the minimum size of space and also the minimum size of frequency band and implementing the minimum or simple software on the mobile node system or the mobile communication parts. At the mobile nodes, the simple software has been introduced in order to operate with the mobile IP and introducing the solutions to communicate with the multiple addresses at the same interval of time, right? These are all the goals of the mobile IP. And coming to the requirements, what are all the challenges? That is when the requirements that are being taken along with the mobile IP to be introduced to make it as a standard. So we've been discussing that this is the requirement of the mobile IP. Why? Because we doesn't move. The mobile communicating nodes doesn't move in the case of IP communication, so that the mobile IP needs the mobility. And at the same time, the communication shouldn't be broken up. And how the standard communication will be maintained in between the two parties without breaking the communication, maintaining the same IP address, but changing the point of attachment. So all these are nothing but the challenges that have to be posed with the mobile IP while it is being introduced. We have been introduced to the IP with certain goals, that is solving the mobile users problems and introducing the simple software on the side of the mobile node and giving the solutions for the mobile to engage with the multiple addresses. All these are nothing but the aims of the mobile IP after its introduction. It has been came with those sort of aims. But what are all the challenges it has to face in the real time to work with the existing IP networks to execute the mobile IP? We are having the existing IP network, right? IP facilities are there with us in the normal protocol stack. But we have to execute it for the mobile computing environment. So to execute the mobile computing environment along with the existing network facilities, what are all the challenges that we have to face in the real time? That is the first thing, that is the compatibility. That is nothing but all the communicating networks are being only compatible for the IP communication. They has to make compatible with the mobile IP devices, that is the mobile communicating devices. They has to get a integrate or combine or compact, or they have to get matched with the existing operating systems, routers, network, and all these things are being already existing things. They are being tuned to the IP communication, but they has to get accustomed or they has to get matched up with the mobile communication facilities also, right? And it shouldn't require or it not requires any MAC or LLC protocols, so it must use the same interfaces and mechanisms to access the lower layer APIs. And already we know that the MAC is going to be get communicating with the IP mobile communication without any special equipment. Okay, the existing equipment itself, the MAC can provide you the corresponding mobile communication, right? So that finally the end system should be communicating with the mobile IP, and they shouldn't change the existing equipment. with the existing equipment itself, they has to be get communicated or they has to be get tuned with the mobile communication. That is, the compatibility is the first feature that is to be get tuned with the existing IP communication equipment. Next one is transparency. Mobility remains invisible for many higher layer protocols and the application. That is nothing but the higher layers wouldn't observe. They couldn't have the idea or they couldn't have the view that the users are going to be moving. All these things are going to be taken care of by the lower layers itself. That is the physical layer, data link layer, and the network layer. They are going to be taking care about whether the user is going to be moving, whether the point of attachment is being changing or not, or the IP address is being changing or not, or whatever it is. All these things are being identified by the lower three layers itself. The other upper layers are not aware of it, even though the higher layers are going to be identifying that they are going to be reaching over the lower bandwidth, or they are going having the corresponding some interruption in their services while handing over the signal from one radio cell to the other radio cell. All these things have been observed by the higher layers, even though they are going to be observed by the higher layers. All these things while managing with the mobile communicating points, they are going to be remained calm, and they are going to be managed by the three lower layers. In that way, transparency is being maintained with the higher layers, the having the invisibility of this host management and the point of attachment is going to be changing over by the mobile users, right? And next one is the scalability and efficiency. That is nothing but the particular efficiency of the network shouldn't be affected. Even though the corresponding, what is called as number of users are going to be increased with the available space and with the available frequency space. Frequency band is very lower in size and space is very lower in size. With the available space itself and with the available frequency band itself, we are accommodating much number of users. And how you are been accommodating much number of users, how the more number of users using the same frequency band in the, within the same interval, that we are already discussed in the first unit and the second unit, that is not the matter here. That particular scalability shouldn't create any bottleneck for the network. That particular scalability issue, that is nothing but increasing the number of users with the existing frequency band and with the existing space, shouldn't flood our network. That is creating more number of communication messages which couldn't pass through the corresponding network node. All these are not going to happen, right? All these are not going to be happen while increasing the number of users. That is another issue to be faced in the real time. And at the same time, the same efficiency characteristics and the throughput characteristics has to be maintained even with the increasing number of users. Okay, that is the thing that we have to take care while working with the mobile IP. Why? Because with the normal IP communication, the users are not going to be getting increased. The existing IP addresses and existing IP users are going to communicate with the existing path of communication. But with the mobile communication, it is not the case. We may have much of rush at the particular moment of time on a simple network. Or another time, in the another interval of time, the network will be remaining idle and no users are going to be using that one. In this type of scenarios has to be faced by the mobile IP communication. With the existing equipment itself, with the existing space itself, with the existing frequency bands itself. So that particular scalability, that is increasing nature or advanced or enhancing nature of the network, has to be maintained properly. In the same way, parallelly, the efficiency of the network is also to be maintained. Okay, so the first one is compatibility issue will be rising. There is a difference in between the IP and the mobile IP, so that the compatibility issue has to be resolved. And next time, the transparency has to be maintained between the lower layers and the higher layers while maintaining both the IP communication and the mobile IP communication. And the same moment, the scalability and the efficiency features are also to be maintained. And finally comes with the security. Why? Because obviously the mobility possesses every time the security problems. As you are going to moving from one radio cell or our own radio cell to the foreign radio cell. So what we are foreigners to the another radio cell. Whether our identity is going to be changing or whether our identity is being securing in the another cell or not, or our data is going to be secured by the other cell or not, this is to be taken care of. Okay, it must be sure that IP layer is going to be forwarding our packet of information properly to the corresponding receiver or not, or whether there is any IP fake or a fake receivers are there by corresponding counterfeiters or any tappers. So that thing it has to be taken by the responsibility of the internet protocol layer itself. Why? Because we are not remaining status static, and our IP address is going to be changing the point of attachment as we are moving from one point of place to the another point of place. So you are being getting registered with the new MSCs and the BSCs. So whether you are being secured while getting the new registrations while moving over from one point of location to the another point of location, that is to be taken care. So the security of our identity, security of our data and voice has to be taken care by the IP layer. It is the sole responsibility of the IP layer in order to find out that whether we are being connected with the proper IP address or not while communicating. And if that particular address is fake or not, it has to be identified by the IP layer itself. So that these four challenges are the requirements of the mobile IP has to be facing in real time. Okay, so that the mobile IP communication can be summarized, or a mobile IP goal can be summarized in a different way here. Supporting end system mobility while maintaining the scalability, efficiency, and compatibility in all the respects with the existing application and internet protocols itself. We are not changing any equipment. We are not changing any protocols. We are not changing any networks and everything. Whatever there in the IP communication procedures, all are going to be implementing for our mobile communication. That's it. But what we have to do is, mobile IP communication is going to be supporting all the end users, okay, while maintaining the scalability, efficiency in the same time, and compatibility with all the existing equipment and also the internet protocols. That is the goal of mobile IP, facing all the four challenges and giving you the corresponding goals, right? And some entities we have to learn about. Some entities we have to learn about while moving with this mobile IP. That is, while we are learning into, or we are getting into the mobile IP communication, the terminology, that is entities and the terminologies regarding the technical things that you are working with this mobile IP. We already know about the IP communication nodes, right? That it is routing node will be there, communicating node will be there, traffic bridges will be there, traffic gateways will be there. In that way, the IP communication will be having its own terminology, right? So, but here, as we are working with the mobile IP, at the mobile communication, the nodes will be changing its names. Why? Because there will be different things. We have to have the handover mechanism, and you have to have the security mechanism. You have to have the what is called as encapsulation of the data, tunneling of the data, how you are doing with, what is the traffic node, what is the routing node, what is the mobile node, what is the subscriber node. All these things has to be learnt about. That is, while you are entering into the mobile IP architecture or mobile IP environment, we have to get aware and we have to get familiar with different entities and the terminology. And here we are given with certain terms like related to that, according to the standard of the RFC, 3344. This is one of the entity that is pertaining to the mobile IP. There are various versions that are came into way of mobile IP, but we are learning the entities and the terminologies that are related to the RFC standard. RFC 3344 is one of the standard that has been introduced into the mobile IP communication. According to it, we are learning about different communicating procedures and the terminology that are helpful for us in order to learn about the mobile IP communication, right? So these are all the different entities according to the standard of the RFC 3344. And the first node, that the first term that we have to learn here is MN. That is nothing but the mobile node. So this mobile node is nothing but an end system or a router that can change its point of attachment from point to point. That is, by using the mobile IP, by using the mobile internet protocol, a particular end user, or say a subscriber who has been initiated the call, he is going to be changing its point of attachment with the help of mobile IP using the internet. Okay, the mobile node keeping its IP address and continuously communicating with any other mobile node or any other node on the other side with the help of the internet, as long as the link layer connectivity is given. That is, LLC is there for us, right? Link layer control or link layer protocol is there. Using that particular link layer, until and unless we'll have the logical establishment of the connection using the help of the LLC, until we have a connection with the help of that LLC, we are going to communicate continuously and we are having the same IP address. Okay, so like the mobile nodes may be of category laptop, mobile phone, router, on an aircraft, whatever it is. So until and unless we'll have the logical establishment of the connection with the help of the LLC layer in the data link layer part, we are going to continuously communicating and we will be calling as the mobile node with a corresponding IP address assigned with us. Okay, a particular IP address assigned to the laptop, a particular IP address that is assigned with the mobile phone or a router are all the examples of the mobile nodes here, right? And next one is the correspondent node. Correspondent node is the one which is the other party that has been communicating with the mobile node. Correspondent node or a CNS, one of the at least one partner which is needed for the communication, whereas so mobile node. So the mobile node is going to be communicating with the corresponding node itself. Okay, the corresponding node may be fixed or mobile, or a particular mobile node may also be fixed or mobile, whatever it is. The correspondent node is the one which is the communication partner of our mobile node. It is at least one. The corresponding nodes may be many number, that may be existing in many number, but there should be a one correspondent node. Why? Because as you are being communicating, we are called as the mobile node, our receiving party or the other subscribing party will be the correspondent node. And next one is the home network. Home network is nothing but a subnet that particular mobile node belongs to with respect to its IP address. No mobile IP support is needed within the home network. Why? Because as we are being not moving, for example, as you are not moving, as you have been attached with the same IP address, that is the mobile node is being attached with the same IP address and it is going to be communicating, the particular network to which it is belonging or the subnet mask of that particular mobile node is called as the home network. So until and unless the corresponding mobile node is moving from its home network, it doesn't need any specific mobile IP support. Okay, so once it has been moving over from its own home network, then it needs the mobile IP for the communication. I think I am clear, right? We are been working in our own mobile home network or own home network and we are attached with some IP address and we are been communicating with our correspondent node with our IP address itself. But if you are been moving, you are not been remaining static at no more and you are been moving, then we need the support of the mobile IP in order to communicate with our correspondent node. Okay. The next one is foreign network. The foreign network is the current subnet the MN visits and which is not the home network. So while we are moving, until and unless we are remain static, we are being existing in our home network. But whenever we are moving, we are entering into our foreign network and you are going to entering into another current, another subnet of our IP address and you are going to connecting with that particular foreign network to continue our communication. That is about the foreign network, right? Right, and coming to the foreign agent. So what is a foreign agent? See, this foreign agent is the one which is going to providing you the services for the mobile node while you entered into the foreign network. What it is doing, it is going to provide you the several services to your mobile node while you enter into the foreign network. And this particular foreign node can have the COA. What is the COA? Is nothing but this particular COA is nothing but the care of address. So this particular care of address is going to be possessed by the foreign agent and is going to be tunneling your endpoint forwarding communication. That is, end-to-end communication of your packet data will be done with the help of the COA, which is done or handled by the foreign agent once you entered into your foreign network. Okay, that is nothing but the FA is nothing but your router for your mobile node. Once you entered into the foreign network, your FA, that is the foreign agent, will be acting as your router to forward your communication. Okay, and it is also providing you the security. It has also been opposing what is called as it's going to be doing the subnet duties, the subnet masking duties, and is also acting as a router for you and is also acting as a security for you until and unless you are been remaining in the foreign network, right? That is the foreign agent which has been acting as a router for your mobile node once you are entering into your foreign network. It has been taking care of your tunneling and encapsulating of your packet delivery from your sides to the correspondent node side while doing your communication without any break. And while it is going to be providing you the routing, is also providing you the security also. And coming to the care of address, this defines the current location of the MN from an IP point of view. This is the address which is given by your router. That is nothing but the foreign agent. It is giving you another new address for yourself, which has been considered as the IP address of your mobile node now. Okay, your home address mobile node IP address is being changed over once you entered into the foreign network, and your new address has been assigned to you by the foreign agent. That is nothing but the router of your foreign network. It has been assigning your new address, which is possessed with corresponding foreign agent itself. That address is called as the care of address, which is nothing but a new IP address of your mobile node. Okay. And all IP packets and all the data will be delivered through the COA itself. Okay. And the tunneling will be done by this particular care of address itself, and it's going to be tunneling at your endpoint and where it's going to be existing the tunnel. And right from the sender side, from your mobile node to the corresponding node, it has been carrying over the same address of it. The same COA is going to be following until your communication ends. That is from the mobile node to the correspondent node, the packet will be delivered with the address taking along with it as the COA itself. Not your home network address will not be taken. Your foreign network address, which is in the form of the COA, which is assigned by you, is assigned to you with your foreign agent, will be taken care by the packet. Okay. And okay. So we are being ended at the session. That is, the time is getting over. And this particular COA has been existing at two areas. That is, the two possibilities, two different possibilities of COA we are having. That is, for foreign agent COA will be there, co-located COA will be there. Where this foreign agent COA will be using, and where this co-located COA will be using. The corresponding address, that is, the COA should be located at the FA. The COA is an IP address of the FA that you know. The FA is the tunnel endpoint and forwards packet to the MN. Many MN using the FA can share the COA as common COA. See, for example, if you are being moving from your home network to the corresponding foreign network, and similar like your mobile node, everybody are been changing their positions so that they are moving from their own home network to the corresponding foreign network. So that for their foreign network, they will have the common foreign agent, that is FA. So until and unless those group of users maintain the foreign agent as in common, they will have the same foreign agent COA in common. Until and unless those group of subscribers, those group of mobile nodes will have the same common foreign agent, they will have the common foreign agent COA. The same IP address will be followed by the all the mobile nodes which have been entered into that particular foreign agent control. Okay, they will be maintaining the same mobile IP address or the COA address, care of address. Okay, whereas coming to the co-located COA, this co-located is going to be temporarily acquired by a particular traditional IP address which acts as COA. This is a temporary address. This address is now topologically correct and the tunnel endpoint is at the MN. Co-located addresses can be acquired using services such as DHCP. For example, if you are been remaining in your what is called as foreign network for a long interval of time, that is, while we are moving from our home network to the foreign network and you are been staying to the end of our call in the same foreign network, then you are being assigned with the foreign agent COA. Then you are assigned with the foreign agent COA. Otherwise, while you are traveling, for example, if you are been traveling, and while traveling, you are been moving from your home network, and you are going to be changing different foreign agents while you are communicating with your correspondent node, until the termination of the call, you are being changing the foreign agents very rapidly. In that case, you are being achieving the co-located COA. Why? Because you are not retained with the corresponding FA for a long interval of time. While changing that particular radio cell, we are being changing or moving to the another foreign agent within the another time. That is, while talking with your receiving mode itself, we are changing different number of radio cells so that we are changing the foreign agents also. So as you are changing the foreign agents very rapidly, for example, you are traveling in a train or while traveling in a plane, you are being changing over different radio cells so that you are being assigned with different foreign agents. In that case, while entering into one particular radio cell and you are moving very rapidly, you are not remaining static and you are not giving time to the corresponding foreign agent to assign a foreign agent COA, then you will be assigned with co-located COA. As you are moving very rapidly from that radio cell and leaving back that particular COA address and entering into the another new cell while you are traveling to the distant apart, then you are going to assign with the co-located COA. Okay, in that way, temporary users are being assigned with this co-located COA, and the permanent users, permanent in the sense they are not being constantly attached to it, but they are been remaining idle for some interval of time until the completion of the call, then they will be assigned with the foreign agent COA, right? So these are all the different terminologies. Some more are there. We'll be seeing in the next class. As the time is running out, I'm ending here, right? So refer these topics while coming to the next class and complete the assignment which has been posted in your Edmodo yesterday evening. So complete the assignment before the time interval. Before it gets locked, there will not be any excuses for this particular assignment. So please do that before the due time and it gets locked. Okay, I'm ending here. Please refer the topics before coming to the next class. The time has been ended.